The Artist of the Year is an annual award. It recognizes an artist for outstanding achievement in the discipline of performing, visual, or literary arts.
It's a great honor and a privilege to be here tonight, helping to honor Morton Marcus as Artist of the Year for 1999. I was lucky to have grown up in the home of artists. My mother was a jewelry designer. My father, as I thought about it in this last week, had many similarities to Morton Marcus. He was a professor of English and American Studies at a state college in New Jersey for a tenure about as long as Morton's. He loved sports, he loved music, he loved film. And he wrote. He wrote serious works. He wrote a grammar book for students. He wrote not-so-serious work. He wrote some Hardy Boy books and Tom Swift books. And he was a great guy, and he died a long time ago. And about 10 years after he died, I was back at my mother's house in Connecticut and pouring through boxes of his things and writing and notes from lectures and found that he'd actually been a poet as well. And had the pleasure of essentially editing his poetry work after many years after he died, which was a really wonderful experience for me. But what I found interesting, I do little speeches like this. We do this all the time. We give proclamations, and you're always looking for a little quote that's germane to the subject. And I went through Ralph Waldo Emerson and Walt Whitman, and they're, of course, full of things about what poetry is and what poets do. But I found this little piece by my dad about what poetry is. And it was interesting because I think it sort of sums up what Morton's poetry is, and it's written in a way that Morton would have written the poem. It says simply that poetry is a spawn of the heart, relentlessly webbing its cool contentions like spiders before daylight. And that's what Morton has done all his life. He's enriched the community here for many years. I don't normally read these proclamations, but I think so that I don't leave out facts, I will read this. On behalf of the Board of Supervisors, it's a distinct pleasure to honor you as the Artist of the Year, to join the other artists of the written word, William Everson, and your friend Jim Houston, Audrey and Rich. And this is a proclamation honoring Morton Marcus as Artist of the Year. Whereas Morton Marcus is an internationally known poet who has published 7 volumes of poetry and a novel, and whose poems have appeared in prize poem annuals, more than 70 poetry anthologies, and more than 350 literary journals. And whereas universities throughout the nation have invited Morton Marcus to read his poems and conduct workshops, including Columbia University, Notre Dame, and the University of California campuses. And whereas Morton Marcus has been called one of the most readable and moving poets of our time by Pulitzer Prize-winning poet Charles Simic, and of his recent work, critic Peter Johnson said, Marcus's great gift is his ability to nudge us into imaginary worlds. He is writing some of the best prose poetry being published today. And whereas, as a teacher of English and film at Cabrillo College for 31 years, Morton Marcus has inspired and influenced countless students. And whereas Morton Marcus has been an organizer of the Cabrillo Poetry Series, co-presenter of the Wordquake readings, co-host of KUSP's radio's Sunday Night Poetry Show, and a steering committee member of the Pacific Rim Film Festival, which you all want to go to on May 9th, I think. Now, therefore, I, Jeff Almquist, chairperson of the Santa Cruz County Board of Supervisors, acting on behalf of all the members of the board and the Santa Cruz County community, do hereby proclaim Morton Marcus as Santa Cruz County's 1999 Artist of the Year, honor him for his significant contributions to the arts and to the community of Santa Cruz County, and thank him for enriching all of our lives with his written word. Thank you very much. Beginnings of a trophy wall here. There's also a nice proclamation from Senator Bruce McPherson's office honoring you for this distinction. So, congratulations to our Poet Laureate of the Year.
Good evening. Well, I don't know Jeff Almquist at all, but he ought to be on television. He just gives the greatest introductions in the world. is the second one, and it was just marvelous. And Marcia, that was really moving. And I think that's probably going to be the best thing of the evening, folks. I want to thank everyone I've just done, and I want to thank the Arts Commission for choosing me to be Artist of the Year for 1999, and though it probably hasn't crossed your mind, the last Santa Cruz Artist of the Year for the 20th century. In many ways, I feel that the 20th century was my century, not just because I've lost my hair and I'm white hair, but because this was really a century in which there were an awful lot of hopes and an awful lot of dreams of what could have been. And let's hope that the 21st century can possibly fulfill at least some of those. I also am very proud to be in the group that has preceded me, great artists like Lou Harrison, who I have had respect for and whose work I've known and listened to since years before I was here. He is a national treasure, but a Santa Cruz treasure, as so many other of the Artists of the Year have been. Adrienne, of course, is out of this world, as I've written in reviews about her work. She really is marvelous. But I want to take this opportunity to publicly thank Jeff Dunn. Where'd he go? There he'd be. I don't even have to say what for, obviously. I want to thank him for the incredible article he wrote about me. In the midst of four hectic careers, there are very few instances when a writer and artist of his caliber takes the time to learn about someone else's work in depth in order to provide a window for the public on that person's soul. I love you, Jeff. Okay, let's have some ground rules here. Because I am over-prepared, so here we go. This has been the worst week of my life because I realize I like a lot of what I've written. The ground rules are this. If you've never been to a poetry reading before, and I think most of you have, so I just put this in here anyway, just go with the words wherever they take you or they don't take you. If you're going to go to sleep, just do it silently so you don't disturb the person next to you. The second thing, though, is if you think something is funny, please laugh. Poetry does not have a capital P, it has a small P, and it is for all of our enjoyment. And what I'm going to be throwing at you tonight are many different moods and many different attitudes towards life. Because what's coming at you with poetry is a human voice about all our experiences. So, who am I? Why am I up here? There's an old biblical saying, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. This piece is called Doing It to Others. In Croatia, where I've just been, the Serbs really did it to the poor Croat farmers, my truly wonderful in-laws. But every moment I was there, I was aware that the Croats had done it to the Serbs, Jews, and Gypsies 5 decades before. And the Jews did it to the Palestinians afterwards, and the Gypsies are now doing it to everyone, and everyone is doing it to everyone else. And I wondered where that left me. On the one hand, the poet singing about the joys of being human and alive, and on the other, the child of immigrants who, like everyone else, distrusted, feared, or hated anyone not like themselves. I know that whoever I am is carrying with me my ancestors' distrusts and hatreds, as well as their longings for an end to suffering and injustice. And as a poet, I am singing both the hatreds and the longings from a deep place. Or rather, my ancestors and people, dispossessed or dispossessing, are singing them through me, as yours are through you. And we have little choice but to let them, even though we know that whoever our people are, they'll do bad things to others, when they get the chance. However, when we get that chance, we can change everything. For then our people's hatreds will be as much our personal possessions as they ever will be, along with the longings for an end to injustice and victimization. And we can choose to merge the hatreds with the longing so they become reminders to everyone that whoever we are, we were once the sufferers and should now remember that, and should open our fists and reach out our fingers to the others as if our fingers were magic wands that can transform the world. So who am I? My family thinks I'm a pessimist. There he goes again, my wife and daughter say, rolling their eyes when I mention an airline crash or predict the end of the Republic. It's been going on a long time, and I'm sure it's because of my name. Morbid, my mother would say so often when I was a boy. You're morbid. She said it so much that I thought she was teaching me my first name, as if I were an idiot who couldn't remember how to pronounce it. Mort is death in French, Henry Franklin explained in the schoolyard when we were 10 and smirked when he said it. I walloped him good. But secretly, I was proud that unlike the Henrys, Joes, and Jacks, my name meant something in the scheme of things. Actually, I'm neither a pessimist nor an optimist. I just envision the cleanup for the birthday party before we order the cake. And the stacks of dirty dishes before we set the table. I'm not arguing here in my defense, but it's a little disconcerting that when a friend calls, "Hey, Mort," and I turn, his face is falling inward and he is being whisked backwards into the eternal darkness before I can say hello. Now when someone calls a greeting, I shrug and mutter, "Goodbye," before I turn to see who it is. But I don't want to make too much of this. Let's leave it at me being just like you with my aches and complaints. But as for things turning out for the best, or you having a good day, I wouldn't count on it. So who am I? Once, coming on the Pacific Ocean over a white hill, I saw a woman on the beach below, clothed in a black robe, who dissolved before my eyes. And I could not recall whether I was arriving or departing, but there where the woman had been, my shadow was waiting, bent and crooked in the dawn sun. And I knew that this was what I had come for, all those miles from my birth and the many voices of dust who had whispered me on my way. On the shore, I stepped into the shallows, watching my legs slur into sea foam, and without looking, I knew my face, my hands, even my voice were water. I do not know much. I have no solutions. I only knew that tonight, when my mouth opened, I did not want my voice to be a gunshot. What I wanted to say was something simple. It was about this dancing the Greeks do. Those specks of sunlight they snatch from the sea, swallow and hold in their bodies until they glow, until the warmth moves their lives into postures of joy, sorrow and joy, anger and joy, lust and joy. And I wanted to say that there is this patch of light in all of us, a mote of sun-drenched dust drifting and spinning in our darkened upper chests. Sometimes it makes it hard to breathe. There's so much joy. And sometimes, as now, it seems to disappear, leaving our chests full of ashes, soggy with ashes. But it is always there. This sun speck shines in us, shines in the dancing, in the names the Greeks give to their dances. Tsamiko, Zybekiko, Hasapiko, Ziftateli. This is all I will talk about tonight. This music, this need we humans have to dance, to make of our sorrows and joys a tree, a fish, a rooster, to make of them our dead family and friends. Let us join hands tonight, sway, tap toes of our shoes on the floor, leap, whirl, smack our heels with our palms. We will dance together, brothers and sisters, into the future, the living with the dead, together, my friends, with the olive and the laurel, the redwood and the bay, and the stones and the sea, and the stones and the sea. So, who am I? I am three or four people. The man ripping the upholstery, slugging sofa and desk in the study downstairs. I am the woman lifting belly and back as she opens her legs to the dark in the upstairs bedroom. I am the one in overcoat and hat who stands in the rain outside watching the house. Well, for the next, approximately the next hour, so I don't, secret is not to do this too long. For the next hour, I'm going to try to show the different people that I am. And my belief, very simply, is, as I said in the very, very first anthology I was in, I found out that there were many people inside me and many people who wanted to speak, many people who could not speak before. All this gets very mystical, but I'm a poet and I'm allowed to do that, right? And that is what my life has been. And the creative process for many of the people who have been here, as they know, if you have never had it before, do it in any way you want in any of the medium of art, because there is nothing like it in life than getting into a creative high. And if you've never known it, you really haven't lived that part of life. It has nothing to do with how good your stuff's going to be or what the finished product is. It's just that experience itself. And when I go there, I'm suddenly speaking in different voices, and I'm saying things, even in language and vocabulary, as you could just tell the differences, that just astonish me all the time, because they're certainly, they don't seem to be mine. And you've heard that many times before from other artists. Okay. Who am I, simply? I was born in 1936 in New York City. People say you can still hear my accent. From the age of three, I was shipped off to boarding schools and summer camps for all but 3 years until I graduated from high school. And I had a very turbulent childhood, and I'm not going to go into it too much, but what I want to say is I was almost always the new kid at more than a dozen schools. And besides all the fighting that had to be done at that point, the reason I'm telling this is that I was also one of the most lonely kids, because I was always isolated. And this really is the beginning of my poetry, because I began to entertain myself by making pictures in words. You see, painter friends of mine all over the room, I cannot draw even a stick figure. I have accomplished drawing the face of Dick Tracy in profile. Which I will demonstrate at the drop of a hat, but that's it. And so what I began to do was tell myself stories, and I would make the stories vivid by actually putting these stories into words, and words that were word pictures. I had no idea what I was doing. And you have to realize I was flunking every class I was in, every school I was in, and that is where we're getting. Anyway, by the time I was 14, I had made a serious decision, being a very, very sharp, streetwise human being. And that was that women seemed to think that poets were very sensitive people. And so I began to write poetry, or I carried a pad and pencil around, with the idea that I would attract women, or girls. right? And that continued for a few years. At 14 also, I began to attend a series of Ivy League prep schools, three of them in all, because my mother always wanted to make my life better. And that's an important part of my story. My mother is an immigrant who came over on the boats, and as so many others of so many other racial and ethnic groups, our story is theirs, and has certainly made me proud to be an American, and proud not of the melting pot, but of the separate ethnic mix of everybody and racial mix of everybody. Something we seem to be forgetting more and more, not only over here, but it seems like it's all over the world, like a bad breath just surrounding the planet. At any rate, the first school I went to, I was an experiment by Gray Madden III, who had graduated from Yale at the age of 23. And we would like you to be the first Jewish boy who will attend our 200-year-old school. Well, this was great because my mother wanted me to go to Yale. I wanted to go to Yale, and the Irving School, which was named after Washington Irving in Tarrytown, the Irving School prepped specially to Yale. So in I went to the Irving School, and within 1 week, I had broken one kid's nose. And listen to this, this is what you remember. And I had thrown Charles Curtis III through a window. That's all right. We realized this was going to be difficult. But we will make a gentleman of you. Well, my prowess, which came from New York, playing basketball, quickly came to the fore. And I was first string on the team the very, very first year as a freshman. Second year, I came back on a basketball scholarship. If you want to know why there are basketball scholarships in prep school, I'm not going to go into that right now, but it was a wild, corrupt time in New York, Connecticut, New Jersey. And finally, at the Milford Military Academy, my career at Irving ended because I punched someone out in a basketball game. And Gray Madden came into the locker room. Everyone wanted my blood. And he came in and he says, "Well, I think it's time to part company. You are no gentleman and will not be a gentleman." But he very nicely let me stay for the rest of the year after sending me home for a suspension. Then let me stay for the end of the year, and then I was gone from there. Well, continued to other prep schools, and by the time I was finished my senior year, I had flunked out of high school. And I immediately enlisted in the Air Force. It was the end of Korea, and I enlisted in the Air Force and spent the next 4 years in the Air Force. The big turning point in my life. First of all, I learned discipline. You know, everyone says, "Oh, the military's terrible." The military's not terrible. I think a lot of people can use what the military can give you. It taught me discipline. It taught me how to achieve things and how to go about thinking about achieving them. And at the same time, it caused one of the great traumas in my life. Because at the end of my second year, it took me off the base basketball team because I was involved in various Air Force defense teams. And that was the end of my basketball career. And I knew of no life beyond basketball. I mean, in these prep schools, I was given the key to the gym every single season. And with the other guys who were on scholarship, this is all I did. I would just, you know, hop classes and everything. And my life was basketball, even in New York on the playgrounds and then in summer camp. So I suddenly had lost a very important part of my life. By this time, I had already gravitated to poetry. It was no longer, and maybe it never was, concerned with women. It was concerned with something else. And I think poetry smirked behind its pentameter hand, its five fingers, if you will, and knew that it was addicting me. And by the time I was at the end of my first year in the Air Force, there was no turning back. Last year, deciding that that life was really what I not wanted, the drinking and the brawling, I got my mother to send me all of my books, took care of high school, went into Washington University and night classes, and met Jarvis Thurston, the great poet Mona Van Dyne, and they became my mentors, and my first national publication happened in 58, and they also got me into the State University of Iowa Writers' Workshop. And there I was an undergraduate, did all my undergraduate work there, but I was in the graduate workshop. And what did I learn in Iowa? Great undergraduate school, terrific undergraduate education. Now I was following Isaac Babel's grandmother's dictum to him, you must learn everything. Now I was just voracious in just learning everything. And that, if you ask why I'm a jack of all trades, it's because I just literally am a brush fire through anything I get interested in. However, what I learned from the writer's workshop was what I did not want to do in poetry. And that, very simply, was I did not want to work in closed forms anymore. I would write sonnets, sestinas, villanelles. I was not in it for doing that. I was not in it for writing stories from fairy tales or myths. I was in it to talk about the human condition. I was in it to talk about the way I saw life. And I was going to do it on my own terms. Okay? Came to the West Coast, attended Stanford and for graduate work, and met Jim and Jeannie Houston, a friendship which was to have arcing significance, all right? But while I was in San Francisco, after that I went to San Francisco and was finally teaching in a high school there and also coaching basketball. But while I was there, I got all involved in the Haight-Ashbury Renaissance. And this taught me about art and community involvement. And I was part of a group that everyone has forgotten called the Artist Liberation Front, which was really the start of it all, start of Woodstock, start of everything else. 350 of us from San Francisco. The egos were so great that the thing could never last. But I met George Hitchcock there, great actor. You know him from down here. And I was the vice chair of Neighborhoods Committee. He was the chair of Neighborhoods Committee. Got interested in my poetry, began to publish me, and after a number of appearances in Kayak, did my first book, which was called Origins. And what I'm going to do is sort of go through these books, or tell you a little bit about them. And they will be, if you're interested, you can look at them back there. They will be sold, many of them, in the back here afterwards. What's Origins about? It's about the archetypal family, extremely abstract, mother, father, sister, brother. The second part is creation myths. Again, very, very mythic. The third part is about games human types play with each other. And death poems end the last part. A structure I'll come back to again and again. But this is really a sequence, and it's an attempt to give all of human experience. I've talked enough. Let's get into this. Let me just read you one of the games, and just around three or four poems from this book. This is the game of hearing. One listens to the stomach troubles of stars and hears molten food and the laying of gases. Another hears the turnstiles in his neighbor's mouth by which the neighbor walks in and out. The last hears the operator inside his head dialing the number that will blow him apart. They stand together, listening to their ears, but none of them has heard the month of their death as it grinds up behind them, unable to stop. I'll read you another one of those. This is called the game of touch, and notice how the artist comes in here. One puts his finger on the meaning of life, and death bites off his head. Another touches his exact center and falls through his skin. The third feels along the edges of a universal night and turning a corner finds a costume party of noisy friends. The fourth caresses the wind, makes airy shapes with his hands, and watches them go bounding off to populate the world. And that, of course, is the artist. One of the myths. And this begins my interest in women and the situation of women in our times before there was real activity going on. And this is called, very simply, Mothers, and I read it for my wife. Here are the mothers beating on the doors of grass. No one lets them in. The days skim by above their heads, a continual sunfall as they move from hill to hill. Listening into stones, stooping under clouds, they wrap themselves in breezes soft as shawls. On a brown path, they discover seeds and rub them warm between their palms. There are no birds, only the beaks of dissatisfaction pecking at their knees. But they hold the seeds to one side, blowing on them their black membranes of breath. At night, they sleep in grottos of the wind and wake each day miles from one another, but not alone. And the seeds jump from their hands, popping into tiny suns wherever they land. When the new grass grows to sunlight, the mothers are nowhere to be found, but young girls, timid and alone, are beating on the doors of grass. Well, you were right about that one. There are three poems that have been continually anthologized from this book, and I want to read them to you. But I read this first one from Mark. Learn to be water. Direction is any way you can travel. Your shape, whatever you naturally become. Let the moon strum your belly. The planets beckon and tug. Learn to be water. Okay, look at my head. We'll see how awake you are. It's written at the time when the Beatles were very big and women were entranced over men's long hair. And I was losing mine. Baldness. Yes, hair grows, but baldness grows too. In bed at night, you can hear it growing. Not rustling, not sticking out its nerve ends from the borders of hysteria, but emerging from the forest like a moon. And of course, Poem for the Left Hand, one of the first object poems of which there would be poems throughout all the books, and not only poems about objects, which I'm going to read at least one more, but poems about body parts. In every one of my books, my body parts is thrown through. Someone was just saying, I was talking about my belly poem. This was the first one, Poem for the Left Hand. This whole book was under the influence of the great Yugoslav poet Vasco Popa. Who I got down here as a State Department representative who visited the area in the huge Yugoslav at that time, population of Watsonville. It was a marvelous evening. And then we went up to Berkeley and read with Czesław Miloš at University of California Slavic Languages Division. Vasco's dead now. He was Serbian. He was a lovely, wonderful man, and if you heard my program around 4 or 5 weeks ago, you know that I paid homage to him. The Serbs are not animals. No one is an animal. We demonize everybody. It's horrendous. I am not going to excuse what's going on over there, but let us not make the same mistakes generation after generation. I'm allowed to preach up here. Poem for the left hand. All you gotta do is watch my hand. Watch the birdie. Thumb. Blind, bald-headed blunderer. Moron I might have become. Eyes, nose, mouth stopped up with cushions of flesh. An impermeable thickness ideas cannot enter. Blunt as an infant squatting at the village edge. Oblivious to passers-by. Index, the pointer, full of possibilities, lean and muscular, with impatient energies, traces the words in books and soon will be going. Explora, visionary, builder of roads and bridges, now lifter of latches, opener of doors. Middle. Bachelor with bizarre habits. Owns the largest house in the village. Has never traveled, yet speaks of mysterious dungeons that only he is able to reach. And yet his explorations have not made him cynical or cruel. Ring, married, burdened with bills, awkward and short of breath, sits in a large chair staring out the window while his children laugh and run through the house, or reads his brother's letters which tell of cities set like jewels beyond the mountains. Little, inquisitive old man, clean and well-mannered, bent like a question he never asks aloud, lives alone at the end of the village, thinking, these are my people. In this valley I kiss the wind and cage the sun in my hands. Well, my time in San Francisco ended, and a job was offered me at a strange place called Cabrillo College. And for you people who have not lived here a long time, you don't know Bruce Bratton's pilgrimage and a banner for the correct pronunciation of that name. It's a lot of joy that we had in that years ago. I called up Jim and Jean Houston, who had been asked, by the way, they're not here tonight because Jim is just coming back from Hawaii, where he's working on another script with Eddie Kamai on yet another film on Hawaiian music. And Jeannie's gone up to pick him up at the airport, so I'm really sorry they're not here. But anyway, they said, you know, we've been telling you to come down here, to come down here. And so they talked to some people at Cabrillo. I came down and gave an interview. I'm sure it was lucky that Jim talked to the people at Cabrillo. I was hired, and I came down to Santa Cruz, and I found a home. Not in the Army or in the Air Force, but I found a home down here in Santa Cruz. And you all know that story, and Jeffrey wrote about it beautifully. The big thing that it did almost immediately was we rented property from this wonderful old couple up in the Santa Cruz Mountains, way off Empire Grade. And for 3 years, I did nothing but live really in the wilds of the Santa Cruz Mountains. It was really my first exposure, the urban city boy from the East Coast, with nature. And with all my studies in Chinese civilization and literature, which I've not gone into because I'm sure I'm boring you enough with this stuff, suddenly everything really flourished, and I would take these long walks in the woods. Mysterious voices would talk to me. I would just write them down in these very hermetic, mystical poems, and really did not quite understand what I was doing for all this time. It was really a confrontation with nature. It was a giving into nature. It was a merging with nature. The book that came out of these 3 years is in two parts, and it is like taking a walk through one day in the Santa Cruz Mountains. But that one day is also 1 year. And you go from the dry season to the rainy season, and you have the entire experience of living in the Santa Cruz Mountains, I hope. Again, another sequential book in which form has all importance. In fact, all the poems in part one and part two, and only one critic has ever realized this, each poem matches the other in its counterpointed opposite from part one to part two. What I'm going to do tonight is in 4 minutes, take you on a very quick walk through the Santa Cruz Mountains. I'm going to go in the same way the book does, and this is going to take no more than 4.5 minutes. So this is sort of a mini walk through the Santa Cruz Hill poems. Okay? And I'm not going to give the titles of most of these poems, so just move with me. They're very, very short. And if you don't get one, just go on to the other. I did not buy the grass, nor the bush kneeling above it. What I own stops with these words and is enough. dawn. The stones lean toward the sun. They rise from their haunches. From everywhere in the meadow, they drag themselves out of their weights, lifting in unison like an exhaled breath. That's it, horse. Release your frothy piss. It's not so bad browsing in a green field while the sun fans your back. So piss on the grass. Pass the happiness on. The forest. Past the flesh leaves, the branches of bone, deep in the woods, there's an emptiness even the wind won't enter. I'm there, a dancing tighter than stone, a rhythm merely, keeping time with the stars. Leaves crackle under my steps, like hands lifting my boots. They pass me from one leaf to another. Do not repeat your mistakes to the trees. Even the stones keep a closed mouth. Learn to spell by the alphabet of stars. Remember, when the weeds trespass against you, only your name suffers. The meadow is a beggar and is about to move on. Bees and butterflies slip from his hair. Wherever I turn, it is away from my children. The rains begin. On my body, each black hair lances inward through my skin. The grass swoons. Small chimes float from sunken pebbles. Rickety as a cart, a beetle drags this moment toward a wind-gray weed. A compost heap. Above the bin of grapefruit rinds and collapsed oranges, above the coffee grounds muddying the carrots, the eggshells cutting lettuce leaves and onions, above the gray beef bones and snowy hills of mold, the bearded flies chant their hymn. With every step, I stream from my body. By the time I reach the top of the hill, I'm a brook flowing the other way. The weed puts out its hand. Take it. Hold fast. We are flying into a long night. I trudge toward the dark. Behind me, my footsteps flutter up, gold-edged in the late noon air, and float toward the sun. The crickets tutor the stars, but the stars already know and never reply. At the same time that book out, the publisher got so interested in my work, he actually put two books out, and the other is one that sold completely out in 5 months, and if you're lucky enough to get it, it's drawing impossible prices in my parlor. and it was called Where the Oceans Cover Us, and I'm going to read one or two poems from that. This is one because I always tell people, wherever I do a workshop in any college, what I want them to get rid of is adjectives. And adjectives are the bane of poets. Nouns are what poets are in love with, very specific nouns. Well, consistency is the hobgoblin of small minds. Ralph Waldo Emerson said that. He said a lot of other good things, too. I got a letter from Paul Blackburn, who, when he was editing Poetry for the Nation, a poem I love. And I'd sent him a poem that had, in 45 lines, four adjectives. And he wrote back and he said to me, there are too many adjectives in this poem. How's that for getting hoisted on your own petard? I got so angry. Can I imagine how my students feel? I got so angry. This one's for Mark also. I sat down and began to do this until I realized what I was doing and what I wrote. Again, one of my most anthologized poems is a one-time shot. You can do this once, no more. Look closely. I hold in my hands one invaluable, unusually large, circular, hydrated cellular fish spine shell pasted, molecular wood fitted, lilac scented, pollinated, earth colored, katanga mined, bantu smelted, cleaned, polished, rough edged, curved, granite, golden crusted, filigreed stamped, platinum inlaid, green embossed, diamond tipped, rectangular sculpted, Polynesian carved, interconnecting, figure locking, beaten, Persian hammered, sheeted, fur covered, feathered, braided, Inca woven, lace trimmed, stitched, beaded, Navajo embroidered, Chinese inspired, Japanese designed, romantic, blue lacquered, hand painted, red enameled, impenetrable, soaring, mythic, hermaphroditic, Hebraic, Gothic, mobile, eurythmic, mechanical, non-plastic, free-spinning, winged, elevated, piece of myself. One of my bugaboos, I got to tell you this, and it got into Jeff's article a little bit, is that I really do feel that I'm very different than what we consider to be the main populace in America, which is the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. And I guess now, as minority groups really meet 50%, especially in this state, and we'll go by it, that'll be great. But I have always given people, I think, a lot of trouble, not only because I'm an SOB, people laugh who know that. But because of my intensity, and I don't think my intensity is me as a person. I really think it comes from my Slavic background. And many of us know, because we got a lot of intermarriages here, that there are a lot of different cultures and a lot of different ways of doing a simple thing like walking in a door or saying hello to someone. And so one of my bugaboos is people who just can't get it out. Right. I guess the phrase now is, as Gray Matter the Third would say it, they can't get down, Morton. Anyway, the one way this comes out, and it's idiotic, Tony likes that. The way this comes out in poem after poem, and I'll just maybe read one other, is that I always glorify, and I wonder what would happen in the Greek dance thing, right? So I love about the Greek dance thing. Men get up, they dance alone, they dance with each other. It's unthinkable over here in America. And this is because they know you have joy. When you walk down the street, you've heard it, you've seen it many of you many times. Greek men walking arm in arm. Just good friends. That's what friends should do, you know. I understand it very well. And I think that's why my wife and her family, the wonderful Mekas clan, have been so wonderful to me, because they are, by and large, except for Audrey, they are Slavs. So, one of the things that really bugs me are people who keep that set expression on their faces. You'll see what I mean. The expressions on your face. I'm always surprised when I'm told that someone I know, who looks like a bank clerk, has climbed the Himalayas or paddled down the Amazon in a kayak. There's no hint in his face. The adventure doesn't show. Not like the slick pink scars entrenched on the cheeks of a German student, or in old France, the fleur-de-lis branded on the flowing breast of a female thief. God, you look awful, my friends say. Good, I wanted to show. You look like you've been through hell. I have. When I journeyed to an ancient Inca city, I wanted to send with all the ghosts bloating the inside of my face. I want to bring the buildings, the whole damn mountain down with me, constructed once more inside my bones. Something in me should have changed. Something you can see that makes you stare at my back when I pass. Something that changes you, too. When walking through a city, realize that the corner grocery stores and barbershops, the widows and fathers with runaway daughters, the boy practicing a violin before an open window, the high school girl touching her boyfriend's arm for the first time, and the blacks shouting at the walls of their tenements, the Mexicans chanting rosaries over old land grants, are all trapped inside us. Their bent lights tremble in our eyes and on our stomachs lake. Even the metals in the earth below the street vibrate in our breath, show in the expressions on our face. Touch this poem. Feel the murmurings inside it. Hear tree roots sipping moisture beneath the park, or in your neighbor's window, the daffodils digesting gold-edged water in a plain glass vase. That drunk, collapsing against the galvanized garbage can, is collapsing around you, just as his urine-stiff clothes collapse around him. Go on, pull a face. Dignity's got nothing to do with the joy exploding behind the bones of your cheeks or the sorrow uncoiling from your throat. So, my friend, if you see someone with an expression as bald as an elbow, who looks like he's never gone to the bathroom, tell him what I've said. Or better yet, show him in the way the scowl crawls down your face or the smile cracks open your lips. You ever thought about what goes on in trees? You may believe that inside a tree there are many voices discussing directions. But I say there is silence inside a tree, and no matter how loud you call, no one will answer. And you may think the leaves gossip, but I tell you they are solitary hands unable to applaud the wind. Now, there are no sounds inside a tree. A tree does its work in silence. It is a tall solitude we all must come to. Only the processions swimming toward it are noisy, slamming gongs, hooting, shimmering into small pools near stones. The earth is full of such noises, of those on their journey to the tree. And another one, which was made into a poster by the bookshop Santa Cruz many years ago, and which has really gotten around, whales. Our future plunges with a whale. Chilled water weighs against our skulls. Flat forehead forces a passage to that slow darkness miles below, where it swaggers into whale shape. That round unrolling from the end of darkness to the beginning of light. We slide up through fathoms of his shadow, budding the underside of water until we break through the surface and bask in the sun. And when we roll in the swells and release an easy breath, his spout is a halo above our heads. Figuring you might be getting a little tired now, I go to props. Hang it all, Robert Frost? No. Object poem. Teaching creative writing at Cabrillo, forcing everyone not to use adjectives, and finally telling them, bringing in an old shoe and having them write on an old shoe, right from the viewpoint of a shoe. Boy, they must have loved me. Well, I went home that night, and I was alone at this period in my existence. And I sat on the bed looking at the two yellow, soiled bottoms of my feet. That's an image of loneliness, stolen from T.S. Eliot. And I looked in the closet, and there was this hanger, actually several hangers, wire hangers. It must be wire hangers. And so it was, those black. You see that? And I just suddenly grabbed my pencil and I dashed this down. Hardly ever dash anything. Stuff may sound spontaneous, but it's worked over and over, so it seems like a moment's thought. But this was just dashed off. And it seemed to me, and this is why I have the prop here, that what I was seeing hanging from that pole was the head of a bird with its wings trying to lift itself. Very short poem, an object poem. What I love, and I gotta tell you this, I have never known the ending to one poem I have ever written. Poetry is self-discovery for me. It has nothing to do with art. It becomes art when I have to take those words and make them an experience for you. All right? That's the communal act. So that's what this automatically did. I think writers do that automatically because they immediately know that they use concrete language. See, the language is always concrete, again, getting away from adjectives. So people can experience those concrete nouns in bursts of what we call images, sense impressions in words, those word pictures that I did all those years ago in those boarding schools. So here it is. I'm not going to read it. I'm going to read three sections. I'm not going to give you the numbers between them. An amazing self-discovery for me in this. Clothes hanger. He is the bird whose wings are always rising, only to be held down by the gravity of our clothes. When we rip our coats from his shoulders and he is suddenly naked, jangled, spinning in the light, he emits a small song, a chiming, cheap, but only when he and another nude bird touch. Realize this, his shape is our skeletal design. When we load our jackets on his back so we can shower, sleep, enter the lives of our lovers, then we are naked, flapping, ready to fly. If you're wondering how long this is going to go on, it ain't going to go on more than an hour and 15 minutes from the moment I started, so if you got to take a deep breath, do it. I am fascinated by my obligation to the dead, the past, the tradition. And over again, one image presents itself, an image of a line of people marching from the past into the future. And I know where I got this, and many of the more mature people in this audience remember the march of time newsreels from the 30s and 40s. And that's where I got this. And it's just become a metaphor that's indelibly put on my mind. And one of the best examples of it is a poem called The Long Line. Join me. You've had no choice anyway. You're in the line. Each morning I slap my chest, stretch my arms and say, so this is life. This is my body. Well, what do you know? This is grand. And try to forget all the dead bodies from which my body has emerged. That infinity of deaths leaning against me as if I walked at the head of a long line made of bones. Sometimes I lean back, trying to shove the line into a closet with my shoulder. But the weight behind it is immense. And so it follows me all day, footstep to footstep, leg to leg, its chest against my back, pushing me forward. I slam my elbows into it, try to kick it with my heels, then flick the sweat from my forehead, saying aloud, so this is life. This is my body. Well, what do you know? This is grand. It's like being the head of a battering ram hurtled toward a concrete wall. And it picks up speed, I swear it. Each day it picks up speed, hustling me forward, and I must jog to keep up, saying, so this is life, this is my body, etc., etc., until I'm sprinting through the streets as if running from my shadow, shuffling errands like a card sharp, while barbers and old ladies shake their heads. It will end against a building or the grill of a truck. I know I'm being aimed, but I don't know at what. Maybe at the boy in front of me, whom I bump with my belly and steer by the elbows, and who endlessly recites, "So this is life. This is my body. Well, what do you know?" Again, another one about the past. This was done, Peter Beagle and I gave some performances out in Duck Island. I don't know how many people were here then. And we did it on Halloween, and it was based on Peter's very, very funny, scary stories. And I did a whole lot of poems to mimes who were doing this on popular superstitions. And this one was the superstition of spilling salt and throwing it over your shoulder. Right? And it's called spilling salt. And just watch how the long line and its sense of things gets in here. When I spill salt, the sea trembles. The house shifts in its skin. It's best to toss some grains over my shoulder then. A hailstorm in the life of a mosquito, but a sunny day in the life of men. Walking through the dark house when everyone's asleep, I sometimes see the tossed salt grains, small white shinings on the rug, caught in a slow upsway. Kneeling, I lift them to my face. They glow, an opaque white, like the dust of bones. And when I put them to my ear, they sound like the sea's breathing. Although now, with so few of them, I can hear individual voices, the muffled cries of drowned sailors and all those who have died and been drained to the sea, all my cousins. On my tongue, these crystals dissolve with the small, lost bitterness of tears. And when I enter the kitchen, the salt shaker is glowing on the shelf, a vault full of voices, a choir of lost kinsmen. That is why, when I spill salt, I toss some grains over my shoulder. It is not to mollify the gods, no. I am thinking of that night when I will kneel on the carpet and place the tossed salt crystals on my tongue and take their sorrows for my own. It is as though each time I throw the salt behind me, I reseed the oceans and rebury all the dead. It's always leaving laughing, so you know what? I'm going to leave you laughing. Now I got to read this one. The next book I went into was Pages from a Scrapbook of Immigrants. I went back and didn't look at an abstract archetypal family, but went and looked at my family. And for 7 years, I wrote, really, which is one of my two favorite books, and that is Pages from a Scrapbook of Immigrants, the story of my family's life in Russia, their immigration into the United States, the hardships that they overcame, in some cases did not overcome, and finally, the passing on the baton to me, my move becoming a poet. I'm in there in the third person as the boy, because I didn't want it to get sentimental. So it's, what it really is it's a chronological panoramic novel after Tolstoy, but in 56 verse poems. And it finally ends up in probably the best poem I ever wrote, which is you've got down there, which is called It Begins Right Here, which leaves my children with a responsibility for the rest of the world at the end of this continent. There are many poems in here that I could read. This book is all just too long. Poems are too long. But there are portraits of my family, incidents that have happened. And I'm just going to read this one. And I just ask you to get the date. And remember, I'm the boy. I'm in the third person, but I'm the boy. And this is the kind of life, the vibrancy that we all should want. Not to be afraid of things, not to say that everyone is, you know, trespassing against us so that we have one law case after another all the time. But just to live life and not whine. And I hope you get these brochures that are coming around called Writing on Writing. It may anger some of you, but I think what I have to say outside of poetry in those brochures, especially if you're a writer, I hope means something. It's the only thing I'm going to read from this book. In 1943, the boy imagines. That's the title in the first line. In 1943, the boy imagines that hefty waiters swoop and whirl among tables of roaring men, their hands high overhead, swinging two or three bottles by the neck, or trays slicing through smoke like river barges laden with merchandise. Customers, waiters, most wear aprons, full length and white, some splattered with axle grease, others with flour and blood. All of them laugh too loudly, faces red and sweaty, bodies pink and hairy, black beneath their clothes. They shout and eat, toast the stuffy room, yell, "To life and God is good," eyes gleaming, fingers snatching food from passing trays. Those eyes know wool and grain, plate, silver, oil, and leather in the dusty market square, but know the people who shop there even better, know the roads beyond the village and where they lead. Their cousins cry in the wilderness and it flowers. Their uncles rise suddenly, upsetting tables and dance in billowing circles, their vision of the world that God has promised them. And the mamas and the frauen scold these drunken boys or screech at walls and laundry, at pots and pans. "This can't go on. It's not a life, I'm telling you." They clasp their hands and weep, these women, then sigh and clean the house once more. While in doorways on the market square, squatting on stools, aunts and widows tear feathers from dead hens and gasp each time the linen grazes a tense nipple inside their clothes. This is no country for those who cringe and cower. These people understand any excessive gesture, any thought or act that flings the leaping blood through the body's crooked streets, anything that grasps and grasps at life. Shopmen, grandmas, scholars, laborers, wives and daughters, their every flourish and shrug, their every toothy grin is done in the sanctity of God's embrace, as if the air that encased them and clamped the woods and fields in place sat on God's desk inside a paperweight. His will was theirs and would be done if they had the patience to wait for it. And as the boy imagines this, his lineage, guided by gun butts, shuffles through the gates of Auschwitz and Buchenwald. I'm going to read three more poems. That's it. So get ready for it. I've abandoned going through these books. Three more poems. Men Who Cry. My stepfather was the first I knew who did. A square-faced man with a broken nose, who was always ready with a curse or a fist. He blubbered when the woman in the black dress, big as the side of a building, sang Romanian songs in the little restaurant on the east side, while my mother looked on and the waiters with black mustaches standing against the walls sucked their teeth and smirked. There were the boys who wept because they had come so close but in the end had lost the championship, and others who wept because they had won it. There were army buddies sitting in foxholes or barracks holding the letter that said, "Forgive me, I'm going to marry Tim," while the tears slipped down their faces and they continued to hold the letter in front of them like a flower they no longer had anyone to give. They were hardly more than schoolboys, really, who years later, as fathers, listening to an old pop tune on the car radio as they drove their kids home from the movies, would remember that letter and weep again, hands gripping the steering wheel, not wiping the tears from their cheeks. I have known men who sobbed when they remembered strolling hand in hand with their fathers through the cool of an evening in a garden or city park. They wondered why he had abandoned them and searched for him all their lives, only to look in the mirror one morning, bleary-eyed and alone, to find that face that was looking back at them was his. And then there was the writer who wept whenever he read his stories to an audience. His mouth worked hopelessly around the words, the emotion blurring whatever he said. He had been famous when young, but fate and changing tastes had passed him by, although he wrote as well as ever. I thought he wept for the unrecognized beauty of his words. I was wrong. There are men who cry for their youth or something they lost in it. Others weep in fear of old age or for every moment that passes them by. But there are some, and I think the writer was one, who cry for others. I won't say that he and the ones like him have been sent among us to weep for us all, but they have an understanding that sees the end in all beginnings, and they mourn for the living as well as the dead before we and our world are gone. These men are not indifferent to the world or aloof. They do not spill their tears in condescending pity, but as an expression of a suffering so personal, it grabs their hearts like the hand of someone falling away from them on a mountainside. I don't count myself as one of this group. But recently, tears have rolled from my eyes when I see the simplest things. Lovers kissing on the street, workers waving placards on a picket line, a boy alone shooting baskets in a backyard, and all those teenagers I pass who wear the same expressionless masks I discarded long ago. We can shout against the injustice and cruelty of other men, but how do we protest the elemental sufferings of loss and death? Like a moth beating against the window light, our anger must soften into a butterfly of lamentation in the end. This is the wisdom most old men keep to themselves. They suffer from the knowledge that they have learned almost nothing, except that to be human is to be a fulcrum, balancing joy on one side and sorrow on the other, life on the palm of the right hand, death on the palm of the left. But sometimes you see an old man passing lovers on the street, or boys shooting baskets in backyards, and suddenly, for no apparent reason, he begins to weep. Two more poems. I guess I should read one of them, one of the new prose poems, which has been taken up all my life in articles and publications and everything for the last 7 years now. Two more poems. This sort of explains where my imagination has gone, if it ever was had left here. It's called The Stone Flowers, and it's for Donna, and that's why I want to read it, because it's for her, and for Nico, and for Jonna, and for that empty seat there who's Valerie, and for my mama. 91 years young. There was a time when stones flowered. I need to believe that. In forests and fields, layers of black rock cracked open after rain, and slick pink petals swarmed into the wet sunlight. And those who saw this weren't astonished, because such blossomings happened all the time. As recently as the 19th century, miners reported seeing chunks of coal blossom with blue flowers as tenuous as flames. Some said walls of coal sprouted blue flowers all around them, and with picks at their sides, they stood speechless at the wonder of it. On the beach at night, I've seen the sand shimmer with a green phosphorescence. The next day, I imagined the sand was acres of seeds, and I thought, that's what this earth is, seeds. And when I look up at the stars sometimes, I think that's what this planet is, a seed hurtling with others through space. When my wife weeps for our son or the death of a relative, I think of all the seeds scattered over the earth like unlit points of light lying gray and dull next to golden specks of mica and the glassed-in worlds of opal with their trapped swirls of celestial flame. I know that the earth is full of cinders and hard seeds that have never blossomed, and that it makes no difference if pink flowers once surged from layers of black rock, or if one day the planet will crack open and shoot a pink and blue geyser into the night that will unfurl like a celestial flower. I know that whether times are good or bad, we ride this planet like mites crawling on a pebble. That is why I am not ashamed to say that flowers once blossomed from stone. I need to believe in every possibility. We all do. And finally, I leave you with this, the title poem from my fourth book, Big Winds, Glass Morning, Shadows Cast by Stars. And I thank you very much for being attentive and putting up with me. And I do seriously mean that. I think that if a poet or anyone's going to get up before you, he better have something to give you. Because there's no reason wasting your time. Big Winds, Glass Mornings, Shadows Cast with Stars. Just stick with me on this. It's the last one you're going to have to sit through. The winter nights were black with drafts beneath the bedroom door when I was six, and the icicle man stamped and chimed outside. His breath was star bits that whirled, star bits that shivered and boomed, a shower of filings and fossils, cinders, crystals, and shards of obsidian. Although once the night was a thick black wine where someone had pressed raisins into all the star holes with his thumbs, and the wind was a brush that scrubbed the sky with a morning clear as glass you could see through, but not in. It was that day, I think, that I began to lean my head to the side so I could see the dazzling edge, the hidden seam of things. Although teachers and aunts and little girls thought I was trying to look beneath their skirts and slap my face or scream me into corners where I stood for hours squinting at the juncture of two schoolroom walls, hoping to discover the crack, the fissure, the secret opening that would lead me high above a valley where palm trees swished and people lived forever singing in little huts. The teachers and the girls were right, of course. For there were stars beneath my great aunt's skirts, and wind so sweet and close, I thought that I would suffocate when I sat beneath them when I was three, and a stargazer, even then, would look up as one looks up in church to search the vaulted ceiling high above and sees only shifting shadows or the flutter of bats. I learned then that everything was shadows you could reach for, but never touch. Glass mornings, shadows cast by stars. I have always wanted that exact place, that moment where day touches night and cold touches warm, where waking is fastened to our sleep, our dreaming fuses with our daily sight, and our living merges with our death. A day falls from a year. A leaf falls from a tree. A spider from a web. A tooth falls from a child's jaw. A dream from an old man's head. In the story, the spider tumbles onto the leaf, and with the tooth to wish on, they both sail off in the twilight of an old man's dream toward a glass-clear morning. All things touch. Star bits that whirl and boom outside my door, brushes that scrub. The great wind shakes the oak tree by the throat, Weeds gossip and sing. Solitary or among enemies, friends, placing one foot after another in no apparent direction. Among tenements and sewage plants, or in this field where my shirt is running away with me, I know my life is an endless linking, that each moment is the dazzling seam, the hidden edge, where all things great and fall, small, touch and join and dance. You know, the Russians, which is what I am Slavically, have a great tradition, which is the performer claps for the audience. Thank you very much. There's food, there are books. Enjoy.
There's wine.
There's wine.
Wine.
Thank you, Michael.
Thanks, my friend. Thank you.